Let's start with that news in China.
Right, it's not surprising that Baidu would go ahead and try to work on a ChatGPT type product. This thing has taken English language sources by storm. It would make sense. And Baidu being China's Google, they have the amount of data that it takes to actually train one of these very large models. This is a kind of AI model known as a transformer. So Baidu would naturally go into that space and make something.
When we talk about the hype, I mean, you are an academic, a researcher in this field. Right. When you see a name like Baidu moving into this space, do you think that they are a credible player? Do you think, okay, I'm interested in what they're working on here?
They're definitely a credible player. I mean, they have mass stores of data. They are already in so many different spaces. Google's in that space, Microsoft, Facebook, and whatnot. And so it makes sense that they're going to take these kinds of technologies and move into the space where they're building these models that can generate language at such a large scale and take a massive amount of queries.
I mean, much has been written over the years about the race in AI between US and China, and for many, they were thought that China was ahead, particularly when you think of all the language basis, the way in which they have connected devices in the home. I'm interested, Dr. Hanna, in what about the ethics race here? I have a feeling that many would say the US is thinking about that, but are they thinking about it quickly enough? Are they thinking about some of the biases that are baked in within artificial intelligence? Are they trying to think and get ahead of that as it starts to take us by storm?
I think they're trying to find out what's happening, but as we've seen with ChatGPT, when you feed it some kinds of inputs, especially around race and gender, it produces these biased outputs, and this has been shown time and time again. Since we don't have a lot of visibility into what Baidu's doing, we're not sure what's going to happen there. We've seen their uses of AI be biased against certain ethnic groups, like the Uyghurs. So it's not quite, we don't know necessarily what kind of biases are going to happen there and how it's going to exacerbate further inequality there.
Is it exacerbating racial, gender, class inequality at the moment in the US already, or are people managing to tamp down or at least start to learn, ensure that that's the models aren't building that in?
I think there's a potential for it, definitely. In English language, there's less of that possibility just because there's been, these issues have been documented by many people before. But as these things are being used in other domains where we don't have a good idea of what kinds of biases may be baked in, especially when it starts getting away from English language, there's not enough data that really is there and not enough regulators or legislators focusing on that to prevent that from happening.
Let's talk hype.
Let's talk hype.
Well, you know, I think that Caroline and I have gone over with you in the show in recent weeks, worries about plagiarism or how artificial intelligence might contribute to inequality across race, gender. But everyone's talking about artificial intelligence nonetheless. There's an interest to use it. Does that worry you or excite you?
It does both. It worries me because I think the way that we think about artificial intelligence, we think about artificial intelligence as this kind of separate consciousness that is going to emerge as this thing of science fiction. We talk to ChatGPT like it is an actual person, but really what it is something that is taking existing data and reproducing in patterns that it's seen before. But it has a lot of ways in which it could be generative, it could be helpful, it could help human flourishing, especially when we're thinking about ways in which language technologies could be useful, especially in places that don't have a lot of good translation, that collaboration could be really fruitful with affected communities. But right now, as it is, especially as it's being controlled by players like OpenAI, Microsoft, and Baidu, it's probably going to reproduce a lot of those inequalities that we've seen before.
Dr. Hanna, what's interesting is that, of course, your DAIR itself, Distributed AI Research Institute, it sort of comes at it from a community-based focus. You're trying to move away from what is called on your website, big tech's pervasive influence. What about the startup, the seed scene, the smaller players within AI that are building something really exciting? We talk a lot about OpenAI and Microsoft, and we know the power that Alphabet has within the realm of AI. Who else is doing this on a smaller scale but with really interesting outcomes?
We've seen this less, I'd say, on the seed scene, at least for what we see the major players feeding, especially in venture capital in the U.S. But we've definitely seen projects like Masakani, which is a collective of African researchers using AI for machine translation on the continent. Also, Lasan AI, who's one of their fellows, Ashman Lash, Teka, works with us in doing machine translation and automatic speech recognition for some languages that are less represented. And so the more and more we see AI being done with community players as a means of sourcing groups that have been less resourced, I think those have been some really exciting uses and deployments of AI. I think there's a push to rush towards doing things that big tech is doing. We've actually seen a mass exodus from places like Google, where people have gone ahead and start to try to develop these large language models. But it tends to be in English, and it tends to be in a way that's going to attract the most eyes from VCs in ways that they're going to get the most investment. So these community-based projects, I think, are really interesting.
Just quickly, mass exodus. Can you quantify that?
I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, but I did see a story about something like 30 researchers that were coming from Google Brain, which is an organization that I came from, had left the company since, I want to say, in the past 2 years. Mostly they found things that were focused on AI, language technologies, and they're afforded that kind of nimbleness and going into the startup space. They can get that seed funding, they can kind of produce a product that might be quicker to market than a place like Google that is a little slower to react in those cases.